Good morning, everybody. Happy Tuesday. We have an amazing show for everybody today. What do we have, Krystal?
Indeed, we do. We got the one and only Senator Nina Turner on. She just announced a massive fundraising haul in her bid for Congress. So we'll get an update from her on all of those things. We also have Ryan Grimm on. He's got a new report on just how corrupt the DCCC ultimately is. But we wanted to start with some big developments on Joe Biden's infrastructure package.
That's right. So the Senate parliamentarian, you'll remember that person, she has gone inside. She's consulted the occult and the astrology gods, blood sacrifice, and she has come out, read the tea leaves to determine, let's put this up there on the screen, from Senator Chuck Schumer. The parliamentarian has advised that a revised budget resolution may contain budget reconciliation instructions. This confirms the leader's interpretation of the Budget Act, and it allows Democrats additional tools to improve the lives of Americans. So let me translate that for you. We have our friend Jake Sherman over at Punchbowl News. Let's put his thing up there on the screen. Basically, what he's saying is that Senator Chuck Schumer has been advised by the Senate parliamentarian that they can have two reconciliations this year, two more reconciliations this year, which means that they can use this two more times, which would basically equivocate to the first Biden reconciliation or Biden infrastructure plan that is in proposal right now, and then possibly the second one. So that's actually quite big because that means they only need 51 votes. But of course, that means that you better have 51 votes. All the Democrats need to come in and be on board with this. And a familiar foe has entered the chat, Krystal.
Yes, indeed. Joe Manchin, as per usual, coming out and taking an extremely hard line to make what Biden's lame proposal already is even worse. He says that as it stands, it's got to change. He objects specifically to Biden hiking the corporate tax rate to 28%. Manchin instead randomly picks a number out of the sky and says that 25% would be acceptable. There's a lot going on here. Ryan Cooper at The Week actually made this point really brilliantly. He's like, these centrists, they don't act centrist. I use that term loosely here. They're really sort of radical in terms of what the American people ultimately want. They don't actually stand for anything. Their whole MO is just to take whatever is offered and make it worse. That's all they ever do. It's not based on any sort of principle, any sort of ideology. They just want to be able to posture how moderate they are and how they stand up to the left in the party, et cetera, et cetera. So that's one piece of what this is about. The other piece of what this is about was identified by David Sirota over at the Daily Poster. If you guys aren't subbed there already, you should make sure to do it. Joe Manchin benefited from some significant campaign contributions from private equity, one of the first private equity firms that converted to a C corporation so they would be impacted by this corporate tax rate hike. They would be very upset, and lo and behold, Joe Manchin also very upset. So again, took in a bunch of money, I think it was $21,000 from executives from this private equity firm that went to be the first one to convert to a C Corp to take advantage of Trump's corporate tax rate largesse. Then, lo and behold, when the corporate tax rate is set to go back up, Joe Manchin objects. So it fulfills two objectives for him. He's doing the bidding of his donors. He's also signaling this silly like dance that the centrists always do of, look how serious I am because I'm not just going to go lock, stock, and barrel with whatever the left of the party wants. It's really ridiculous. And then, of course, Saagar, the other thing is, why is it that the fringe characters on the right of the Democratic Party are always willing to go so hard out of the gates for things that are bad and unpopular, and not just unpopular like in the country at large? It will specifically, I guarantee you, be unpopular in the state of West Virginia.
Supermajority, right.
Willing to go so hard on that, and progressives will like send a little letter, they'll send out a little tweet, and then they'll vote for whatever's on the table.
The whole thing drives me insane, especially on this debate, because it's around the corporate tax rate. The corporate tax rate actually doesn't even matter that much. What really matters is the corporate loophole.
That's
the corporate
totally
tax rate used to be 35%. Guess how many people actually paid 35%? Like the biggest idiots in the world, right? Like GE used to have an entire floor of lawyers making sure that they would pay $0 in taxes. You know what the real way to capture value in our tax system is? Is to go after the financial system. But, and this is actually an under-discussed part of this, the senator from New York happens to be the Senate Majority Leader. And guess who ruled out immediately any increases in taxes on the financial industry? Chuck Schumer. He says, we're not touching capital gains and we're not touching any of this. Looking out for his donors and looking out for his constituents there in New York City.
Yeah, also looking to get that salt tax.
And looking to get that salt tax situation.
In line.
I mean, there's corruption like all the way up and down the line. And actually, this also shows the idiocy of the Republican Party, because they're willing to go to bat wholesale on the corporate tax rate. There are a lot of other taxes. I feel like I'm always going crazy during these discussions, and especially during the last tax reform bill of 2017. I was like, you know, corporate tax rate, again, is not really even that larger big driver of revenue. If we want to really boost more revenue and, you know, rebalance the financial system, rebalance society, the financial sector is the number one target, not even being discussed. The Biden White House didn't even float it. Capital gains tax, nothing. Everything is being talked about.
Well, they did float increasing the capital gains tax for people who over $1 million. So equalizing that towards wages, which is something.
Yes.
Which is something.
But then they dropped it immediately, right? And when Schumer comes out and says it's not going to happen.
Right. Yeah. So, and I mean, you are absolutely correct. We're going to have Jeff Stein on here this week, and I want to get some details from him on the global minimum tax, which is another thing that they're floating here. But yeah, by and large, it's very depressing to see both how Republicans who are now pretending, I saw Mitch McConnell had some quote about like corporations stay out of politics.
Yes. Yeah.
Like, are you kidding me? Do you know what you are and what the Republican Party? You're nothing but a shill for corporations.
How do you think they got there?
That's been your entire path in politics. And now, because of what's going on in Georgia, they're all feigning their anti-corporate bullshit. Meanwhile, they'll be, you know, going lock, stock, and barrel to the mat to make sure that corporate tax rates stay low. It's all so incredibly silly here. But I do want to circle back to the initial news that you led with, which is highly significant.
It is significant.
That they'll be able to do two more reconciliations. It takes, in my view, sort of unfortunately, it takes the conversation about the filibuster off the table. I don't think you're going to hear a lot more talk about that ultimately, because now the two other big pieces that Biden floated that he wanted to get done, they have a path to get done with 51 votes. That's this infrastructure package, which we have the details about. And then there's another sort of social welfare package coming down the line that we don't have all the details about, but we know that he wants to extend things like universal preschool and also two-year community college. So we'll get more on that down the road. And look, reconciliation is a little bit, as we've found out, of a limited process, because apparently Democrats are going to abide by whatever the parliamentarian says. So that puts certain things like apparently the minimum wage hike off the table. But it does give them a vehicle to accomplish quite a bit more. So ultimately, you know, they got to get all their ducks in a row. They got to capitulate to whatever Joe Manchin, whatever pound of flesh Joe Manchin is going to extract here. They're probably going to be able to come to some sort of consensus within the caucus and get something ultimately through. Again, Joe Manchin's posturing here is exactly why I was so upset when out of the gates this package was too small, was really inadequate in terms of the dollar amount, in terms of the priorities and what's getting spent here, and also in terms of the pay for and how hard they're willing to go in terms of redistribution from the wealthy and corporations that have just gotten insanely wealthy beyond anyone's wildest dreams over the past year during the pandemic, because you know that you're going to deal with bad actors like Joe Manchin, which no matter where you start the negotiations at, they're always going to extract their pound of flesh and water down and neuter whatever you put forward. So that's why this posture, and Democrats always freaking do this, of negotiating with themselves before they even put the plan out, why it's so ultimately foolish, because Joe Manchin and Kyrsten Sinema et al. Have to go through their little performative dance of how sensible and reasonable and moderate they are.
And I will say also, my criticisms aside, look, you pass a massive stimulus bill of which all that money is going to people. Just saw this morning, President Biden says that he wants to make eligibility for every adult American for the vaccine to April 19th, which is months ahead of his schedule. He probably engineered it that way. But hey, look, that's smart politics. You know, I'm not going to criticize it. And the third thing is if you pass a multi-trillion-dollar infrastructure bill and you do COVID relief and you've got vaccines, even if none of those things are truly up to the task, like truly to the moment or whatever, given the alternative of what the Republican Party is offering, you are living in a whole new world of politics. I just think that's true. Go and look at how many of those Latino voters came out and voted for Trump brand new numbers, had not voted in 20 years, mm-hmm. simply because they got a stimulus check. If you get a stimulus check, plus you get a vaccine, plus you get a new bridge in your town, or you see your cousin or whatever who has a contracting company, you know, get a new grant from the government or the state or something, or like you and your, you know, somebody that you know, or your husband or your spouse, like these are, again, these are just, they touch your life in a way that nothing that is being offered there from the right
yeah.
is gonna be able to compete with. You are living in a new paradigm of politics at that point. And I think the right and the Republicans will be in a real tough spot. It will be a true test of material politics. Yes, midterms and all of that, there are structural advantages. But if there were ever a place where I think that they could overperform, I actually do think it could be this.
So the infrastructure package, I think, ultimately is going to be fairly diffuse in its impact. Yeah. Whereas the relief package, there was that really visceral, like it's in my bank account. I see it. I feel it. It happened like immediately. Right. My mom, the day, like 2 days after it passed, was like, it's already in my bank account. So I think that was packed actually a lot more of a punch than the infrastructure package ultimately does. But your point still stands. And this is going to be a real interesting test. On the one hand, you have Republicans have huge structural advantages mm-hmm. in terms of the congressional districting and in terms of the Senate and just in terms of history and the way that the party in power is often punished, almost always punished in the first midterm election. So Republicans have those things going for them. And then they're going strictly on culture war.
Yeah.
All in. And they put out this memo about, oh, how do we keep our, you know, new burgeoning realigned party? Every single thing they talked about was just basically cultural signaling. No economics whatsoever. Democrats, Biden to his credit, I think this part of his strategy has been smart, have mostly just stayed, kept quiet. He specifically has mostly kept quiet on the culture war issues, stayed out of the fray, sort of a continuation of the basement strategy. And meanwhile, it's just delivering on these super basic expectations are low among the American people. Let me get the vaccines out. Let me get the economy back on track. Let me give you a little bit of a punch in your pocketbook. So those two things going up against each other, it's going to be really fascinating to see what ultimately happens. And I would not be able to wager a guess today. I think Biden could have done more and could have positioned himself even better to run on those material politics where you really see those new projects, new infrastructure projects in your district. I think the impact there is going to be relatively diffuse. But your point about the Republicans is well taken. I saw and I'm interested what your thought is on this tactic that they're taking. The line of attack that they're going on this infrastructure bill is like, well, only 6% of it goes to roads and bridges.
Yeah.
I don't think that's going to get it done. People don't care.
It's like they'll never get it through their heads.
It's also very antiquated to think to be like only roads and bridges count as infrastructure. You go to rural America, people are pretty excited about the potential of broadband access. Maybe that's my bias.
And it's not
something I would really like to see.
They did this during the COVID relief bill. Guess what? Super majorities of people supported it. It's just so foolish. People do not care about austerity politics.
Right.
Every poll ever conducted, every natural experiment now that we've seen in terms of ballot initiatives and deep red states and more, nobody cares. Nobody wants it. And they will just never get it through their heads. It's all they know back from their 2010 days, and they just still continue to misread the entire situation. Even today, how many people are caught talking about the COVID relief thing? Nothing. They're going to attack like discrete elements of the infrastructure package. And look, you're right. Because of how diffuse it is, it won't necessarily be the same level of popularity, but it's still going to pass and people are going to still be like, hey, that's nice.
It's going to be popular.
That's something that I generally support. It won't be 80%. Maybe it'll probably be like 65%. That's still pretty good. Mm-hmm. Better than the Republican tax bill, which was 35%, just for the record. And so, you know, just you go and you look at these things and you're like, okay, well, you just clearly have no idea what you're offering to anybody. And good luck, you know.
All right, we're going to tell you what's on our radars. That's next.